so far?
It certainly has not gone as well as had been expected. The Ukrainians, as far as we understand, have brought the lion's share of their new capability into the fight. They have made some gains. They're looking for weak points in Russia's defenses, but we have not yet seen Ukraine break through the multiple lines of defense that Russia has been able to construct over the last few months. It's still early in the game. Let's wait and see what unfolds in the coming weeks and months. But I do think it's safe to say that as we get to the end of the year, a new military stalemate is more likely than a Ukrainian victory and a success in restoring territorial integrity. I think, unfortunately, we're looking at a war that is going to go on for quite some time.
All right. I've been talking to a senior fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations, Charles Kupchin. Thank you for your insights and for talking to WION World as well today.
My pleasure.
Secretary of State Anthony Blinken has expressed his concerns against the presence of Russia's Wagner group in the coup-hit nation. We're of course talking about Niger. During an interview, Blinken has voiced that the mercenary group is taking advantage of the political instability in Niger. The top US diplomat added that everywhere Wagner has gone, death, destruction and exploitation have followed. He also highlighted that the US is worried about the mercenary group possibly manifesting itself in different regions of West Africa. Now, before dwelling into the details, let's first take a look at where Niger is located. Take a look at this map. Niger is located at the heart of the Sahel region, an area where terror groups like the ISIS, Al-Qaeda, are rapidly expanding. Now, in the pretext of fighting terror, both the US and France operate military bases in Niger. As part of operations to disrupt jihadist groups operating in the wider region, Niger even became the main base for French troops after they were told to leave Mali following a coup there. Now, it must be mentioned that this is not the only reason. Niger is one of the biggest producers of uranium, which is also a big point for France and the West to be located here. Although with Niger's dictator general refusing to vacate his position, there is a possibility of force being imposed in Niger to restore Bazoum back to his position. Even the sub-region's largest economy and dominant military power, Nigeria, would be expected to provide the bulk of the troops, funding and logistics for any military intervention into Niger. With the possibility of military intervention, can the Wagner group save Niger's dictator general? Well, that is a question that needs to be answered, but it will come to the fore only with time. There have been suggestions that the coup leaders have asked for help from Wagner, which is known to be present in neighboring Mali as well. Blinken said he does not think Russia or the Wagner group have instigated Niger's coup. However, the US was worried about the group possibly manifesting itself in parts of the Sahel region. Now, this is the same Russian mercenary group which fought in Ukraine, won Bakhmut for Russia, and also led a failed mutiny against the Russian Federation, which was thwarted soon after. Although that had failed, there is a chance it can seal a victory for Niger's dictator general. Militarily, Wagner will be able to guarantee power to the junta. It will also be the vehicle for Niger's junta to work more closely with their counterparts in Mali and Burkina Faso, where the presence of Wagner has been felt on a large scale. Wagner provides security in Mali and in Burkina Faso as well. The mercenary group works closely with government forces, occasionally trading its military support for lucrative contracts. Now, Wagner's entry can make Niger a flashpoint between the West and Wagner, and by Wagner, as an extension of that, Europe and Russia as well. Many in Niger are bracing for a fight, with the possibility of another major force entering the country.
Situation and development. Spoke with President Bazoum earlier.
Не смогли его эвакуировать, так как привалил его он дверью.
Let's stay with Russia. The residents in Moscow have said the conflict in Ukraine feels closer than ever after more than 50 people were injured in a blast that rocked an optical factory in the town of Sergiev Posad. The blast was mistaken for a drone strike by Ukraine 23 people were admitted to the hospital, including 6 in intensive care. Local officials have opened a criminal investigation into the incident. They said there was no evidence that the plant had been hit by a drone. Windows in several houses nearby were shattered by the blast wave. The cause of the blast is believed to be the violation of safety rules.
Все затряслось, мы не поняли, что такое произошло. Или землетрясение, взрыв такой, с такой силой, что никто не знал, что произошло. Просто дым, облако и прям такой. Поднялся это облако в воздух. Понятно, что такое воздух такой. Горючее поднялось. И прям пыль вот эта сама и легла на наш завод.
Meanwhile, Russian and Ukrainian forces have been hitting each other's military targets. On August 8th, the Russian Defense Ministry say their army destroyed Ukrainian military projects, including tanks and armored vehicles. Ukrainian armed forces also issued a report on the same day saying their army carried out strikes on Russian troops. Russia invaded Ukraine on February 24th last year. The invasion has led to several killings on both sides.
Russia is fuming, and this time it's not Ukraine, but the core issue remains the same. Western powers are stretching their arms in Moscow's direction and continue to weaponize countries in Russia's backyard. Tensions now are rising in Eastern Europe. Moscow says Poland has become the main instrument of the United States' anti-Russian policy. Take a look at this map. Bordering Russia and next to Belarus, you see Poland. The United States' anti-Russian policy continues. Warsaw announced its intention to build the most powerful army on the continent. Russia says it will enhance security at its western borders, as NATO is now closer than ever. Finland officially joined the Western Defensive Alliance in April this year. Its inclusion has already doubled Russia's land border with NATO. Sweden, which is on its way for the same, also shares close relationships with the bloc already. Russia described the process as a serious destabilizing factor. The two countries gave up their long-held stance of neutrality after the Russia-Ukraine war started. Now, Germany's new announcement about arming Poland has added to Kremlin's worries. Germany is set to extend deployment of Patriot air defense systems until the end of the year in Poland. 3 German Patriot squadrons are already present in southeastern Poland since January. Now, according to Russia, NATO's military units stationed in Eastern Europe have increased by 2.5 times since February last year. Meanwhile, Wagner Group's presence in the neighboring Belarus region is keeping Poland on its toes. Wagner mercenaries started training near the border this week. Now, to this effect, Poland is set to send 2,000 troops to its frontier with Belarus. This is to stem illegal crossings and maintain stability. Days into the Russia-Ukraine war, the battle of claims and counterclaims continues. Kiev has not backed down from using drones against Moscow, while Russia has been targeting Ukraine's military posts as well. However, expert opinions say Ukraine's much-touted counteroffensive has not lived up to its hype. Ukraine has been unleashing a string of drone attacks, but Russian forces have held their ground, absorbing attack after attack. Russian officials say they shot down 2 Ukrainian combat drones which were headed for Moscow. Now, Russian officials say that Moscow downed 7 Ukrainian drones on Monday near the Kaluga region, which is less than 200 kilometers from Moscow. And on Sunday in the Podolsky district off the outskirts of the capital city, the latest drone attack comes after Russian missile strikes on the eastern Ukrainian city of Pokrovsk on Monday. The attack killed at least 9 people while wounding over 80 and destroying apartments as well. Russia says in the last week its forces intercepted unmanned drones, Storm Shadow cruise missiles and HIMARS multiple rocket launchers from Ukraine. Up until a month ago, the Russian capital had not been a target for Kiev. Though progress is being made, it is much slower than what Ukraine's Western allies would have hoped. But there is another analogy here, that the drones which are being used by Ukraine, it's more of a face-saving process because they're not doing any kind of damage to Moscow. Now, according to reports, in the last 2 months, Ukrainian troops have advanced at most about 16 kilometers in 2 areas along the region's 160-kilometer front. While Ukrainian forces have been attacking on three fronts, using Western-supplied equipment and training, probing for weak spots along the entire 1,125-kilometer front line, Russians have spent months building the most extensive fortifications and defensive lines. From triple layers of trenches to bunkers, concrete pyramid tank traps and ditches laced with thousands of landmines, which have been laid not just for tanks but for personnel as well. And what is also going in Russia's favor is the speed at which they are able to replenish these mines once they have been used. Now, experts have raised doubts on Ukraine's capacity to recover lost ground. Despite multiple peace efforts, there are no signs of a breakthrough, let alone a ceasefire. With the balance in the conflict unlikely to change soon, Ukraine is nowhere close to gaining back its areas. Now, Russia's multi-layered defensive lines in the eastern and southern parts of the country pose as a major hurdle. Meanwhile, Russia has not gained enough to claim a victory either. And now US is set to get to elections next year. So the question remains, will the West lose its patience with Ukraine? Will it lead to divisions among the alliance that has remained intact since the war started? Will a blame game start now that the counteroffensive has not gone as planned? Who's to blame here?
Into the Russia-Ukraine war, the battle of claims and counterclaims continue. Kyiv.
Now, our top focus on WION, Russian air defenses downed a drone. Authorities claim that the drone was flying towards an unspecified target. According to authorities, there were no casualties. Russian Defense Ministry blamed the Ukraine for the attack, and two of Moscow's airports were temporarily shut down due to the drone flight. The drone strike inside Russia has increased since the drone attack on Kremlin in May this year. On Thursday, Russia said that it has downed 13 Ukrainian drones seeking to attack Moscow and Crimea. Earlier, Russian Defense Ministry reported explosions near the Black Sea port of Novorossiysk, which it says was carried out by the Ukrainian sea drone. Ministry says that the drones were destroyed by Russian naval ships guarding the naval base. Russia says that it has repelled the attack. But a Ukrainian intelligence source says that a Russian Navy landing ship suffered a serious damage. Meanwhile, the Russian attacks inside Ukraine has also increased. Earlier, a Russian missile struck a hotel in the Ukrainian city of Zaporizhia. The attack left one person dead and 16 others injured. Reports suggest that the United Nations staffers used the hotel when they worked in the town. It was the second strike on Zaporizhia in the recent days.
Navies conducted joint patrols in the Pacific Ocean. The warships held naval exercises involving aircraft and helicopters and repelled a mock enemy air raid. Russian Defense Ministry stated joint patrols are monitoring the sea area and protecting the objects of maritime economic activity of the two countries. The China-Russia relationship has seen major shifts since 1992. At the outset, China's population was greater than Russia's, and the two countries had very similar levels of total gross domestic product. Nowadays, China's economy is estimated to be up to 10 times bigger than Russia's. Similarly, trade with Russia is not of major importance to China in terms of value. However, the high share of raw materials, including food, in Russian exports and the transfer of Russian military technology are of strategic importance to China. Now, since 2012, when Xi Jinping was first made General Secretary of the Chinese Communist Party, the relationship has evolved in the face of what both countries consider a rising threat from the West to their regimes. Analysts say Beijing's response to the Ukraine war, referred to as pro-Russia neutrality, has so far been much closer to Moscow than it was in 2014 when Crimea was annexed. Now, at the same time, developments since Russia's invasion of Ukraine in February 2022 have increased Russia's dependency on China. There are several hundred thousand U.S. service members stationed and deployed throughout the Pacific region. It is a region that has long seen the presence of U.S. troops, but rising tensions in recent years have led to an even greater U.S. presence. Here are advancements that Russia is making, which even the West is accepting now. Now, a mandatory evacuation has been ordered for the Ukrainian city of Kupiansk and its surrounding areas as Russia intensified shelling of Kharkiv region and claimed to have captured positions near the city. Moscow has been preparing to mount an advancement on Kupiansk for several weeks now, and here's how it is all playing out. Here's a look at what's happening in the northeast of Ukraine and the importance of Kharkiv for both the nations. Now, Russia is ramping up an assault to capture territory already seized once during the conflict. We have to remind you that Kharkiv was once seized by Russia. It was seized back by Ukraine, and now Russia is again making advancements here. Kupiansk and the surrounding areas of Ukraine's Kharkiv region were recaptured by Kiev's forces in September, and Moscow has since pushed back into the region. Kupiansk city administration said residents could evacuate to Kharkiv, some 90 kilometers west, where they would have the option to move to safer regions. Now, urging children, the elderly, and the sick to leave, the official said, and I'm quoting here, "Do not neglect your safety and the safety of your loved ones." So there is definitely a scare which is out there. The warning came as Russia's defense ministry announced its soldiers had improved their position along the front line near the city, after reporting advances earlier in the week. So Russia is making advances, and all of this is happening while a counteroffensive is very much in play from the Ukrainian side. Now, a spokesperson for Ukraine's Eastern Forces confirmed on national television that Russian forces were trying to break through in the Kupiansk area. Local officials are considering forcing the evacuation of children if the escalation continues and the shelling increases even further. Now, Kharkiv, this region is central to Vladimir Putin's war. Let's understand why Kharkiv is so important. You see, Kharkiv, Ukraine's second largest city, is a major target of Russian forces and has a special place in the Kremlin's version of history. Remember, Kharkiv is closer to Russia than any other large Ukrainian city. Long a melting pot of different ethnic groups, including a large Jewish population, Kharkiv played an important role in shaping Ukraine during and after World War I. Now, you see Kharkiv where it lies, even on the Ukrainian map. It is a strategic point. It served as the first capital of the Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic, a largely Moscow-controlled entity set up in opposition to the Ukrainian People's Republic in Kiev. Now, Soviet forces in Kharkiv quickly crushed early attempts at Ukrainian statehood, seizing Kiev in February of 1918. In a historical essay on Ukraine published in 2021, Putin referred to the events of 1918. He said, and I quote here, "For those who have today given up the full control of Ukraine to external forces, it would be instructive to remember that back in 1918, such a decision proved fatal for the ruling regime in Kiev." It's essentially Putin giving a warning to Zelensky. Will Russia succeed in taking Kharkiv back again? Now, that is a question that is definitely going to be answered, and it seems that Russia is already making advancements in the region. By concentrating their efforts on Kupiansk and surrounding areas, Russia is hoping to fix Ukrainian troops in the region. Now, it seeks to prevent them from moving forward as well. It seeks to prevent them from assisting in Kiev's counteroffensive, especially in attempts to reclaim territory around Bakhmut, south of Kupiansk in Donetsk region. Now, of course, Russia is making a lot of advancements in the region, and we are tracking all the developments here on WION. We'll be right back.
mentioned earlier, Russia recently equipped the Su-57 fighter jets with artificial intelligence-based radio communications suite. The suite improves information transmission between the aircraft and ground-based systems. The Russian Air Force expects to induct around 22 Su-57 jets by the end of 2024 and 76 by 2028. Here's more on the cutting-edge aircraft. The Su-57 is a multifunctional fifth-generation aircraft system that's used for execution of a wide range of combat tasks. The fighter provides covertness of combat operation due to low signature level in the radar field. Now, the Velen is capable of continued supersonic cruising flight. The jet is designed to destroy all types of air, ground, and naval targets. The aircraft, it can be used day and night, including in a difficult weather and difficult interference environment when countering enemy air defense systems. The radar system, it's spread across the jet's body and armament is placed inside its fuselage. The Su-57 AI system assumes some of the pilot's functions as well, including piloting and preparations for the use of weapons. Now, in 2018, the Russian Defense Ministry signed the first contract for the supply of an initial batch of the Su-57 fighters. As per state-owned corporation Rostec, Su-57 serial reduction that has begun, and the first aircraft of the initial batch was delivered to the Ministry of Defense in 2020. So the Su-57 is currently Sukhoi's most advanced aircraft in the model lineup.
Well, it's been more than 500 days since the Russia-Ukraine war started, and both sides have been unleashing heavy weaponry in the battlefield. The United States has so far pledged the most financial support to Kyiv, but did you know that Washington could also be indirectly helping Moscow's war efforts? Yes, despite scores of sanctions slapped by the UK, the United States, and the European Union against Russia, despite many efforts to cut Moscow's access to foreign military supplies, Russia has kept its war machine going, and the oil could well be coming to Washington. Much of Moscow's weaponry, including ballistic and cruise missiles, use components manufactured here in the United States, as well as the UK, Germany, Japan, and Israel. Reports say that microchips and processors account for about half of the components of Russian weaponry, and two-thirds of them come from American companies. But given sanctions imposed on these components, Russia has found a way around through third country intermediaries. Media reports say that 5% of U.S. microchips are reaching Russia through Hong Kong or China. Reports point out numerous companies are located in the Czech Republic, Serbia, Armenia, Kazakhstan, Turkey, and India. Western countries are aware of this. UK sanctions businesses and individuals in Turkey, Dubai, Slovakia, and Switzerland all recently. But earlier in May, the US, UK, and EU published a list of, quote, common high priority items and warned countries that such products must not end up in Russia's hands. The list includes items like integrated circuits, semiconductors, lasers, and navigational instruments. Experts say chasing third-party intermediaries is a game of cat and mouse. Once a component gets in the hands of an intermediary, it becomes difficult to trace it, and by the time one does, it's already too late, as the product has reached the Russian land. Experts also say that a blacklist of suspected intermediaries could prove to be useful.
In the latest updates from Russia, the Russia-Ukraine conflict, both countries continue the exchange of fire across the border. Now, Russian air defenses shot down two drones targeting Moscow in the early hours of Thursday morning. Those drones attacks, they are part of Ukraine's offensive on the Russian capital. One drone was shot down in Kaluga region, southwest of Moscow. The second drone was shot down on Moscow's central ring road. Russia also downed 11 drones near Sevastopol city in Crimea. Well, the drones attacked the city as it serves as Russia's Black Sea naval base. Meanwhile, Russia's missile strikes continue to bombard Ukraine. At least two people were killed and seven were injured in a Russian missile attack on Zaporizhia on Wednesday. Well, earlier, Ukrainian officials had reported these deaths, which was corrected to two. Now, doctors were able to resuscitate one person and were assisted by police paramedics at the scene. Well, to bolster defense capabilities, Germany and Ukraine have agreed on the supply of additional Patriot air defense systems to Kyiv, defense missile systems to Kyiv. Now, the news was confirmed by Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelenskiy in his evening address on Wednesday. After receiving an extension to host German Patriot missiles, Poland is now planning to move up to 10,000 additional troops to the border with Belarus. 4,000 troops will support the border guard on the Polish border and 6,000 will be held as reserve personnel. Now, the Polish defense minister said that the troops will be closer to the Belarus border to scare away any aggression.
On the other hand, Ukraine urged civilians near the northeastern front line to evacuate as Russia ramped up an assault to capture the territory already seized once during the conflict. Kupiansk and the surrounding areas of Kharkiv region were recaptured by Kyiv's forces in September, but Moscow has since pushed back into the region. The Kupiansk city administration said residents could evacuate to Kharkiv, some 90 kilometers west, where they would have the option to move to safer regions, urging children, the elderly and the sick to leave, the officials said, and I quote, "Do not neglect your safety and the safety of your loved ones." The warning came as Russia announced its soldiers had improved their position along the front line near the city after reporting advances earlier in the week. A spokesman for Ukraine's Eastern Forces confirmed on national television that Russian forces were trying to break through in the Kupiansk area. Local officials are considering forcing the evacuation of children if the escalation continues and the shelling increases. In the southern city of Zaporizhia, a Russian strike on a civilian building killed at least one person and wounded 14 others. Among the wounded were a 3-year-old girl and a 14-year-old boy. In Russia, the governor of Bryansk, the region, said two people had been killed after Ukraine shelled the small village of Chosy, about 5 kilometers from the border. Russian regions bordering Ukraine have repeatedly accused Kyiv's forces of indiscriminate shelling that has damaged infrastructure and caused civilian deaths. Ukraine launched its counteroffensive in June after stockpiling Western weapons, but has struggled to make major breakthroughs. Moscow said earlier Thursday it had downed 11 Ukrainian drones nearing the Crimean Peninsula and two heading for Moscow. Moscow was largely spared in the early months of the war. However, the number of drone attacks on the Russian capital has risen in recent months, with the city targeted multiple times this week. On Thursday, Russian officials gave updates following an explosion the previous day at a factory northeast of Moscow. The local investigating committee said 12 people are missing. In the Russian-occupied Ukrainian territory of Novokakhovka, one person died and 14 were wounded in the Ukrainian shelling. Zelensky warned last month that war was coming to Russia and that the country's symbolic centers and military bases would become targets. On the other side of the front line, an oil depot in Ukraine's Western Ravine region was destroyed during a massive drone attack. Tensions have also risen in the Black Sea since Russia exited a deal allowing safe passage for grain exports. Ukraine says it has opened maritime routes for civilian vessels from several southern ports. Remember, in July, Russia said it would consider any ships nearing Ukraine in the Black Sea as potential military cargo carriers. Ukraine Navy spokesman said a first ship would take the newly opened route in the near future. In Washington, President Joe Biden's administration asked Congress for more than $13 billion in new military spending for Ukraine. For more on
on this, our correspondent Susan Tehrani has sent us this report from New York.
President Biden's budget request comes as Congress is heading for a spending showdown this fall. The government has been funded until September 30th, and a short-term extension is expected until House and Senate come up with a resolution for a long-term spending bill. Biden is now asking for some $24 million for aid to Ukraine and other international matters. Of course, he's also asking for more money for infrastructure and disaster relief. However, Republicans and many across the country are concerned about America's unwavering support for Ukraine at a time when the counteroffensive has been stalling and there is no end in sight to some kind of ceasefire or negotiated settlement to the conflict. Biden's Republican opponents seem to become more popular as they oppose these blank checks to Ukraine, while the president insists that the United States will continue to support Ukraine as long as it takes. One of those in opposition is former President Donald Trump, speaking loudly against America's unwavering support in Ukraine, and of course, many Republicans in Congress as well following his lead. Susan Tehrani reporting from New York for WION World is One.
The Russia and Ukraine are well into 18 months of the ongoing conflict, while Kiev continues to receive military support from the NATO military alliance. Moscow has now amped up its weapons, introducing what is known as the country's deadliest missile into its war treasure chest. Now, this is the Kh-50 missile that Russia has now seemingly granted operational clearance to the missile, which means that it is combat ready for war. Local media reports have revealed that the growth in production and active use of the missile in conflict with Ukraine, and the latter should be very worried. Moscow has a range of missiles at its disposal, but most of them are said to have some serious shortcomings in the context of their impact in the war. Now, most of the warring countries' missile armaments can be easily detected and neutralized by NATO's air defense systems, which are being provided to Ukraine for fighting back. This is what NATO claims. But on the ground, though, the situation appears to be different. Kh-50 is said to have a slew of features and advantages over the existing technology that Putin's army possesses. The missile has a low radar signature, giving it greater protection from air defense systems. The missile can also cut through strongly contested airspaces and can combat NATO's defense systems, a feature that is crucial in the war with Ukraine. Kh-50 has a shorter range at 1,500 kilometers, which surprisingly is an advantage, making the missile stealthier in functionality and also cheaper to produce. The smaller size of the weapon also greatly reduces its flight and warning time, a feature that can be of great disadvantage to the enemy. With the war showing no signs of slowing down, the Kh-50, touted to be Russia's deadliest missile yet, might have the capacity of causing some serious damage to Ukraine and potentially tilting the fight in its favor.
...530 days into the Russia-Ukraine war. The battle of claims and counterclaims continues. Kiev has not backed down from using drones against Moscow, while Russia has been targeting Ukraine's military posts as well. However, expert opinions say Ukraine's much-touted counteroffensive has not lived up to its hype. Ukraine has been unleashing a string of drone attacks, but Russian forces have held their ground, absorbing attack after attack. Russian officials say they shot down two Ukrainian combat drones which were headed for Moscow. Now, Russian officials say that Moscow downed seven Ukrainian drones on Monday near the Kaluga region, which is less than 200 kilometers from Moscow. And on Sunday in the Podolsky district off the outskirts of the capital city, the latest drone attack comes after Russian missile strikes on the eastern Ukrainian city of Pokrovsk on Monday. The attack killed at least nine people while wounding over 80 and destroying apartments as well. Russia says in the last week its forces intercepted unmanned drones, Storm Shadow cruise missiles and HIMARS multiple rocket launchers from Ukraine. Up until a month ago, the Russian capital had not been a target for Kiev. Though progress is being made, it is much slower than what Ukraine's Western allies would have hoped. But there is another analogy here that the drones which are being used by Ukraine, it's more of a face-saving process because they are not doing any kind of damage to Moscow. Now, according to reports, in the last 2 months, Ukrainian troops have advanced at most about 16 kilometers in two areas along the region's 160-kilometer front. While Ukrainian forces have been attacking on three fronts, using Western-supplied equipment and training, probing for weak spots along the entire 1,125-kilometer front line, Russians have spent months building the most extensive fortifications and defensive lines. From triple layers of trenches to bunkers, concrete pyramid tank traps and ditches laced with thousands of landmines, which have been laid not just for tanks but for personnel as well. And what is also going in Russia's favor is the speed at which they are able to replenish these mines once they have been used. Now, experts have raised doubts on Ukraine's capacity to recover lost ground. Despite multiple peace efforts, there are no signs of a breakthrough, let alone a ceasefire. With the balance in the conflict unlikely to change soon, Ukraine is nowhere close to gaining back its areas. Now, Russia's multi-layered defensive lines in the eastern and southern parts of the country pose as a major hurdle. Meanwhile, Russia has not gained enough to claim a victory either. And now US is set to get to elections next year. So the question remains, will the West lose its patience with Ukraine? Will it lead to divisions among the alliance that has remained intact since the war started? Will a blame game start now that the counteroffensive has not gone as planned? Who's to blame here?
Now, as Poland ramps up security on its borders, let's in fact take a look as to what is unfolding in the battleground between Russia and Ukraine. Now, since Ukraine launched a counteroffensive in early June, Kiev has now urged its civilians in areas near the front lines close to the northeastern town of Kupiansk to evacuate. Now, this has come about as Russia is ramping up its assault to recapture the lost land in the conflict. Meanwhile, in Kiev's southeastern Zaporizhia region, the frontline town of Orykiev has seen some of the fiercest fighting in recent weeks. The charred walls of what used to be high-rise residential buildings could be seen across the now abandoned town. Sounds of explosions shake the ghost town. The local police chief has said that Orykiev is under Russian shelling.
Це яма наслідок ворожого авіаудару. Самі бачите її розміри. Діаметр вона метрів 20, глибиною метрів 10.
Щоденно на нашу територію обслуговування прилітає порядка 10 авіабомб. Це теж максимально, там до 16 прилітало. Це не тільки Оріх, місто Оріх, а це і громади, і населення. Всі граничать з територією Оріховської громади.
Meanwhile, Russia is now performing an eight-hour-long scheduled flight over the neutral waters of the Barents Sea and Arctic Ocean. Two Russian Tu-160 strategic bombers performed this exercise. And according to footage released by the ministry, the nuclear-capable supersonic aircraft were escorted by Su-35 fighter jets. Russia said that the flight was undertaken in accordance with international regulations.
The British government has expanded the list of sanctions against individuals and firms associated with Russia. In the latest, Britain has imposed sanctions on an Iranian drone maker and other foreign firms. So Britain's foreign ministry has accused Iran of supplying Russian forces with weapons and components for use against Ukraine. The sanctions, they target individuals and businesses based in Iran, Turkey, Belarus, Slovakia, Switzerland and the United Arab Emirates. There are at least 25 new entities sanctioned in all. Now, an Iranian drone maker and seven of its executives are already subject to US sanctions. These sanctions, they prohibit British entities from providing trust services to these firms and individuals. It also imposes asset freezes that will block their assets held in Britain. Now, the British government has sanctioned over 1,600 individuals and entities since the start of the Ukraine conflict.
Ukraine's repeated drone strikes into the heart of Moscow have made one thing very clear. No territory on either side of the Russia-Ukraine border is now safe from enemy attacks. What is interesting is the fact that Russia and Ukraine, instead of just relying on expensive missiles, are more and more relying on cheaper drones to strike at their targets. On the 4th of August, Kiev, in an audacious attack, struck a Russian warship that was stationed at Russia's Black Sea naval base off Novorossiysk. The video of the damaged warship Olenogorsky-Gorniak being towed to the port with the help of two tugboats has now gone viral. Even though Ukraine in its counteroffensive has so far failed to make any major headway, what is clear is that Kiev is managing to pull off some very audacious attacks on Russia with the use of naval drones.
This grainy footage, put out by the Ukrainian intelligence agencies, captures the very moment when a naval drone, armed with over 450 kilograms of explosives, rammed into the Russian warship Olenogorsky-Gorniak in the Black Sea. And hours later, the Russians were seen using tugboats to drag the half-sunk warship to the shore. But this is not the first time that Ukraine has used naval drones to strike at a Russian warship. There have been several instances in the past when a swarm of naval drones have been used by Ukraine to incapacitate the Russian warships. Ever since the 17th of July, when Russia pulled the plug on the Black Sea grain deal and declared that any ship heading to the Ukrainian ports will be treated as a legitimate military target, what has been witnessed is a coordinated campaign of missile and drone strikes that have targeted the Ukrainian ports such as Odessa, Chornomorsk, Reni and Izmail. And the Ukrainian strategy to counter the Russian onslaught on its ports appears to be the use of low-cost naval drones to inflict maximum damage on the Russian Black Sea fleet, according to the Ukrainian claims. But this is a tactic that isn't just being used by Ukraine. As this grainy footage will show you, even Russia has relied on low-cost explosive-laden drones to target Ukrainian infrastructure. On the 30th of July, recognizing the key role played by the Russian Navy in this war, and to make up for the losses sustained by its forces, Vladimir Putin announced that 30 more warships will be added to the Russian Navy by the end of this year.
Today, Russia is confidently implementing the large-scale tasks of its national maritime policy and is consistently building up the power of its navy. This year alone, 30 ships of various classes will be added to its fleet.
But the battle isn't just getting more intense on the Black Sea. Yevgeny Prigozhin's dreaded Wagner militia, which is no longer fighting in Ukraine after the botched mutiny, appears to be probing a new front along Poland's border with Belarus. An estimated 4,000 Wagner mercenaries are widely reported to be training in Belarus. But what is extremely concerning for the military strategists of the West are the numerous hybrid attacks that are being orchestrated along the Polish and the Lithuanian borders. And no less than the Polish Prime Minister Mateusz Morawiecki, who met with the Lithuanian president at the Polish side of the Suwalki Gap, has accused the Wagner group of attempting to destabilize NATO's eastern flank.
There are all kinds of hybrid attacks right on our borders, on the Lithuanian border, on the Polish border, which we have been seeing for the past 2 years. Russia and Belarus are increasing the pressure on our borders. They are increasing the number of provocations, and we have to be aware that the number of these provocations will increase. We spoke about this earlier with the President Nauseda, that this can be seen on the territory of Lithuania. I know also that it can be seen on the territory of Latvia, and we know that it is happening on ours. This is what will happen. This is what provocation is about, this is what intrigue and plotting on the part of Putin and Lukashenko is about, and this is what the operational activities on their side are about, in order to destabilize, in order to create unrest, chaos, uncertainty, and at the same time to show the weakness of NATO's eastern flank to all of our partners in NATO.
Poland is a member nation of the NATO military alliance. Any incident along the Polish or the Baltic borders will trigger Article 5 of NATO's collective security. And even though both Russia and Ukraine backed by the United States are experiencing a shortage of ammunition, what cannot be ruled out is a moment of madness along the Polish or the Baltic borders, which would plunge the whole of Eastern Europe into its biggest conflagration since the end of the Second World War.
Tensions are rising on the Belarus-Poland border. Russia's Wagner group is in Belarus, and this is not sitting right with Poland. Warsaw is planning to send 10,000 extra troops to the border. Now, this will be an addition to the border guards present there already. While 4,000 will directly support them, another 6,000 will be in the reserve. You see, Poland is fearful of hybrid attack, military incursion, and of illegal immigrants crossing into its country. At the heart of this fear is Russia's private militia, who moved to Belarus last month after an attempted mutiny. We're talking about Wagner. The mercenaries have been training Belarusian soldiers with armored vehicles and drone controls, just 5 kilometers east of the Poland border. Moreover, Poland claims Belarus has been encouraging people from the Middle East and Africa to travel to Belarus and cross the border illegally, but Poland says it is ready to tackle anything come what may.
Musimy być gotowi na różne scenariusze, nie wykluczamy żadnego, dlatego zdecydowaliśmy o tym, żeby przerzucić wojsko bliżej granicy białoruskiej, żeby wzmocnić granicę, żeby w ten sposób odstraszyć agresora. Przecież o to nam chodzi, żeby odstraszyć agresora, żeby agresor nie poważył się.
Earlier, Poland claimed 2 Belarus military helicopters flew about 2 kilometers into its territory. An allegation which Belarus has, of course, denied. The border between Poland and Lithuania is a line called the Suwalki Gap. This strip of land serves as a link between Belarus and the Russian exclave of Kaliningrad. If Russia-Ukraine spills over, experts believe that this will be a potential target. Russia and Belarus could close this gap to isolate Baltic republics altogether. We're talking about Estonia, Latvia and Lithuania, who could be ousted from their NATO allies in Eastern Europe. Experts say Russia could use this region to test the waters and see what an incursion into a NATO member country could bring about. Moscow is sparing no quarter when it comes to preparations. Russia says Poland has become a main instrument of United States' anti-Russian policy. So Moscow is also building up forces at its western borders. This after West continues to arm NATO members, including Finland and Poland, around Russia.
Welcome to the program. Our top story today, the US and its European allies are importing vast amounts of nuclear fuel and compounds from Russia. Well, this is all according to an AP news agency report. It is providing Moscow, they say, with hundreds of millions of dollars in badly needed revenue as it wages war on Ukraine. So let's break this down. The report details how these sales, which are legal and unsanctioned, have raised alarms from non-proliferation experts and elected officials. So they say the imports are helping bankroll the development of Moscow's nuclear arsenal and complicating efforts to curtail Russia's war-making abilities. The defense on Russian nuclear products used mostly to fuel civilian reactors leaves the US and its allies open to energy shortages if Putin were to cut off supplies. Now, the challenge is likely to grow more intense as those nations seek to boost productions of emission-free electricity to combat climate change. Now, the West has been reluctant to target Russia's nuclear exports because they play key roles in keeping reactors humming. Now, Russia supplied the US nuclear industry with about 12% of its uranium last year. Europe reported getting about 17% of its uranium in 2022 from Russia. Now, many of the 30 countries generating nuclear energy are importing radioactive materials from Russia's state-owned energy corporation, Rosatom, and its subsidiaries. Now, Rosatom leads the world in uranium enrichment and is ranked third in uranium production and fuel fabrication, according to its 2022 annual report. Now, Ukrainian officials have pleaded with world leaders to sanction Rosatom to cut off one of Moscow's last significant funding streams. Zelenskiy again pressed Western leaders to target Rosatom after Russian forces captured the Zaporizhia nuclear power plant. Now, Rosatom is running the partially shut down plant. Now, International Atomic Energy Agency has repeatedly warned a radiation leak at the Russia-occupied facility could be a major disaster. The US nuclear energy industry, which largely outsources its fuel, produces about 20% of US electricity. Now, the value of Russian nuclear fallen products sent to the US hit $871 million last year. That's up from $689 million in 2021 and $610 million in 2020. Now, Europe is in a bid to largely, because it has 19 Russian-designed reactors in five countries that are fully dependent on Russian nuclear fuel. Now, they are in a bind because of that situation. Now, Europe sent nearly $828 million last year. That's how much they spent on Russian nuclear industry products, including fuel elements, nuclear reactors, and machinery. Well, for more on this topic, we've got Andreas Umland joining us, an analyst at the Stockholm Center for Eastern European Studies at the Swedish Institute for International Affairs, joining us live from Berlin. So great to have you on the program. This is very complicated, and it might come as a surprise to some people, but not so much to others. What do you make of this revelation?
This is, I think, a legacy of basically 30 years of, I would say, misdevelopment of, in general, energy affairs in especially Europe, but also partly North America, where there is still a certain dependence on Russia. We had a large discussion similar to the one currently about nuclear fuel, about gas imports last year in Germany. And Germany was, for the first months after the start of Russia's large-scale invasion, still importing large amounts of Russian gas. And the argument there was by the German government, if we stop doing that, we will crush basically the German economy. And then when the German economy will be crushed and we will have social and economic and perhaps even political problems, we will not be able to help Ukraine in its war against Russia. So this is a very odd situation now repeating itself with the nuclear fuel. As long, I think, as these countries like the US, like, let's say, France, which have these dependencies still, are supporting Ukraine, I think Ukrainians sort of look at it with some tolerance. But in general, this is, of course, a very odd situation. And it's strange that this has not changed to a sufficient degree in the last 1.5 years.
Yeah, you're right to say it is rather odd, isn't it? Because actually, it's just decades of a system that is hard to change overnight. As you say, it's a difficult situation for, say, Germany, because their country is now in recession. And if they don't provide for themselves and keep their economy healthy, then, as you point out, they could have political problems domestically. How can we resolve this situation then? Because it's not going to happen overnight, is it?
The problem here are simply large lobby groups in these countries. They have money and they have political support. We had this in Germany too last year, but then actually Russia stopped exporting gas through the Nord Stream gas pipelines to Germany. And then in a way the problem was solved. And then actually it turned out that some of the panicking that the lobbying groups were spreading, sort of scenarios that the whole of German industry would suffer from a boycott of Russian gas imports. Then it turned out actually that during the last year much less catastrophic. It was actually not at all catastrophic for the German industry. We have some problems now. We are indeed heading towards a recession. But we have basically redirected the gas imports. Something like that, I think, can be also done with nuclear fuel. I think the main issue is here nuclear fuel for the nuclear power plants, but the lobbying is still too strong, as I see it, in many Western countries.
Okay, well, thank you so much indeed for your insights. It's a story we're going to be following very closely as the details slowly emerge. Andreas Umland, analyst at the Stockholm Center for Eastern European Studies at the Swedish Institute of International Affairs. Thank you.
Now, our top focus on WION, Russian air defenses downed a drone. Authorities claim that the drone was flying towards an unspecified target. According to authorities, there were no casualties. Russian Defense Ministry blamed the Ukraine for the attack, and two of Moscow's airports were temporarily shut down due to the drone flight. The drone strike inside Russia has increased since the drone attack on Kremlin in May this year. On Thursday, Russia said that it has downed 13 Ukrainian drones seeking to attack Moscow and Crimea. Earlier, Russian Defense Ministry reported explosions near the Black Sea port of Novorossiysk, which it says was carried out by the Ukrainian sea drone. Ministry says that the drones were destroyed by Russian naval ships guarding the naval base. Russia says that it has repelled the attack. But a Ukrainian intelligence source says that a Russian Navy landing ship suffered a serious damage. Meanwhile, the Russian attacks inside Ukraine has also increased. Earlier, a Russian missile struck a hotel in the Ukrainian city of Zaporizhia. The attack left one person dead and 16 others injured. Reports suggest that the United Nations staffers used the hotel when they worked in the town. It was the second strike on Zaporizhia in the recent days.
Navies conducted joint patrols in the Pacific Ocean. The warships held naval exercises involving aircraft and helicopters and repelled a mock enemy air raid. Russian Defense Ministry stated joint patrols are monitoring the sea area and protecting the objects of maritime economic activity of the two countries. The China-Russia relationship has seen major shifts since 1992. At the outset, China's population was greater than Russia's, and the two countries had very similar levels of total gross domestic product. Nowadays, China's economy is estimated to be up to 10 times bigger than Russia's. Similarly, trade with Russia is not of major importance to China in terms of value. However, the high share of raw materials, including food, in Russian exports and the transfer of Russian military technology are of strategic importance to China. Now, since 2012, when Xi Jinping was first made General Secretary of the Chinese Communist Party, the relationship has evolved in the face of what both countries consider a rising threat from the West to their regimes. Analysts say Beijing's response to the Ukraine war, referred to as pro-Russia neutrality, has so far been much closer to Moscow than it was in 2014 when Crimea was annexed. Now, at the same time, developments since Russia's invasion of Ukraine in February 2022 have increased Russia's dependency on China. There are several hundred thousand U.S. service members stationed and deployed throughout the Pacific region. It is a region that has long seen the presence of U.S. troops, but rising tensions in recent years have led to an even greater U.S. presence. Here are advancements that Russia is making, which even the West is accepting now. Now, a mandatory evacuation has been ordered for the Ukrainian city of Kupiansk and its surrounding areas as Russia intensified shelling of Kharkiv region and claimed to have captured positions near the city. Moscow has been preparing to mount an advancement on Kupiansk for several weeks now, and here's how it is all playing out. Here's a look at what's happening in the northeast of Ukraine and the importance of Kharkiv for both the nations. Now, Russia is ramping up an assault to capture territory already seized once during the conflict. We have to remind you that Kharkiv was once seized by Russia. It was seized back by Ukraine, and now Russia is again making advancements here. Kupiansk and the surrounding areas of Ukraine's Kharkiv region were recaptured by Kiev's forces in September, and Moscow has since pushed back into the region. Kupiansk city administration said residents could evacuate to Kharkiv, some 90 kilometers west, where they would have the option to move to safer regions. Now, urging children, the elderly, and the sick to leave, the official said, and I'm quoting here, "Do not neglect your safety and the safety of your loved ones." So there is definitely a scare which is out there. The warning came as Russia's defense ministry announced its soldiers had improved their position along the front line near the city, after reporting advances earlier in the week. So Russia is making advances, and all of this is happening while a counteroffensive is very much in play from the Ukrainian side. Now, a spokesperson for Ukraine's Eastern Forces confirmed on national television that Russian forces were trying to break through in the Kupiansk area. Local officials are considering forcing the evacuation of children if the escalation continues and the shelling increases even further. Now, Kharkiv. This region is central to Vladimir Putin's war. Let's understand why Kharkiv is so important. You see, Kharkiv, Ukraine's second largest city, is a major target of Russian forces and has a special place in the Kremlin's version of history. Remember, Kharkiv is closer to Russia than any other large Ukrainian city. Long a melting pot of different ethnic groups, including a large Jewish population, Kharkiv played an important role in shaping Ukraine during and after World War I. Now you see Kharkiv where it lies even on the Ukrainian map. It is a strategic point. It served as the first capital of the Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic, a largely Moscow-controlled entity set up in opposition to the Ukrainian People's Republic in Kiev. Now, Soviet forces in Kharkiv quickly crushed early attempts at Ukrainian statehood, seizing Kiev in February of 1918. In a historical essay on Ukraine published in 2021, Putin referred to the events of 1918. He said, and I quote here, "For those who have today given up the full control of Ukraine to external forces, it would be instructive to remember that back in 1918, such a decision proved fatal for the ruling regime in Kiev." It's essentially Putin giving a warning to Zelensky. Will Russia succeed in taking Kharkiv back again? Now, that is a question that is definitely going to be answered, and it seems that Russia is already making advancements in the region. By concentrating their efforts on Kupiansk and surrounding areas, Russia is hoping to fix Ukrainian troops in the region. Now, it seeks to prevent them from moving forward as well. It seeks to prevent them from assisting in Kiev's counteroffensive, especially in attempts to reclaim territory around Bakhmut, south of Kupiansk in Donetsk region. Now, of course, Russia is making a lot of advancements in the region, and we are tracking all the developments here on WION.
Russia recently equipped the Su-57 fighter jets with artificial intelligence-based radio communications suite. The suite improves information transmission between the aircraft and ground-based systems. The Russian Air Force expects to induct around 22 Su-57 jets by the end of 2024 and 76 by 2028. Here's more on the cutting-edge aircraft. The Su-57 is a multifunctional fifth-generation aircraft system that's used for execution of a wide range of combat tasks. The fighter provides covertness of combat operation due to low signature level in the radar field. Now, the Velen is capable of continued supersonic cruising flight. The jet is designed to destroy all types of air, ground, and naval targets. The aircraft, it can be used day and night, including in a difficult weather and difficult interference environment when countering enemy air defense systems. The radar system, it's spread across the jet's body and armament is placed inside its fuselage. The Su-57 AI system assumes some of the pilot's functions as well, including piloting and preparations for the use of weapons. Now, in 2018, the Russian Defense Ministry signed the first contract for the supply of an initial batch of the Su-57 fighters. As per state-owned corporation Rostec, Su-57 serial reduction that has begun, and the first aircraft of the initial batch was delivered to the Ministry of Defense in 2020. So the Su-57 is currently Sukhoi's most advanced aircraft in the model lineup.
Well, it's been more than 500 days since the Russia-Ukraine war started, and both sides have been unleashing heavy weaponry in the battlefield. The United States has so far pledged the most financial support to Kyiv, but did you know that Washington could also be indirectly helping Moscow's war efforts? Yes, despite scores of sanctions slapped by the UK, the United States, and the European Union against Russia, despite many efforts to cut Moscow's access to foreign military supplies, Russia has kept its war machine going, and the oil could well be coming to Washington. Much of Moscow's weaponry, including ballistic and cruise missiles, use components manufactured here in the United States, as well as the UK, Germany, Japan, and Israel. Reports say that microchips and processors account for about half of the components of Russian weaponry, and two-thirds of them come from American companies. But given sanctions imposed on these components, Russia has found a way around through third-country intermediaries. Media reports say that 5% of U.S. microchips are reaching Russia through Hong Kong or China. Reports point out numerous companies are located in the Czech Republic, Serbia, Armenia, Kazakhstan, Turkey, and India. Western countries are aware of this. UK sanctions businesses and individuals in Turkey, Dubai, Slovakia, and Switzerland all recently. But earlier in May, the US, UK, and EU published a list of, quote, common high priority items and warned countries that such products must not end up in Russia's hands. The list includes items like integrated circuits, semiconductors, lasers, and navigational instruments. Experts say chasing third-party intermediaries is a game of cat and mouse. Once a component gets in the hands of an intermediary, it becomes difficult to trace it, and by the time one does, it's already too late, as the product has reached the Russian land. Experts also say that a blacklist of suspected intermediaries could prove to be useful.
In the latest updates from Russia, the Russia-Ukraine conflict, both countries continue the exchange of fire across the border. Now, Russian air defenses shot down two drones targeting Moscow in the early hours of Thursday morning. Those drones attacks, they are part of Ukraine's offensive on the Russian capital. One drone was shot down in Kaluga region, southwest of Moscow. The second drone was shot down on Moscow's central ring road. Russia also downed 11 drones near Sevastopol city in Crimea. Well, the drones attack the city as it serves as Russia's Black Sea naval base. Meanwhile, Russia's missile strikes continue to bombard Ukraine. At least two people were killed and seven were injured in a Russian missile attack on Zaporizhia on Wednesday. Well, earlier, Ukrainian officials had reported these deaths, which was corrected to two. Now, doctors were able to resuscitate one person and were assisted by police paramedics at the scene. Well, to bolster defense capabilities, Germany and Ukraine have agreed on the supply of additional Patriot air defense systems to Kyiv, defense missile systems to Kyiv. Now, the news was confirmed by Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelenskiy in his evening address on Wednesday. After receiving an extension to host German Patriot missiles, Poland is now planning to move up to 10,000 additional troops to the border with Belarus. 4,000 troops will support the border guard on the Polish border, and 6,000 will be held as reserve personnel. Now, the Polish defense ministry said that the troops will be closer to the Belarus border to scare away any aggression.
On the other hand, Ukraine urged civilians near the northeastern front line to evacuate as Russia ramped up an assault to capture the territory already seized once during the conflict. Kupiansk and the surrounding areas of Kharkiv region were recaptured by Kyiv's forces in September, but Moscow has since pushed back into the region. The Kupiansk city administration said residents could evacuate to Kharkiv, some 90 kilometers west, where they would have the option to move to safer regions, urging children, the elderly and the sick to leave, the officials said, and I quote, "Do not neglect your safety and the safety of your loved ones." The warning came as Russia announced its soldiers had improved their position along the front line near the city after reporting advances earlier in the week. A spokesman for Ukraine's Eastern Forces confirmed on national television that Russian forces were trying to break through in the Kupiansk area. Local officials are considering forcing the evacuation of children if the escalation continues and the shelling increases. In the southern city of Zaporizhia, a Russian strike on a civilian building killed at least one person and wounded 14 others. Among the wounded were a 3-year-old girl and a 14-year-old boy. In Russia, the governor of Bryansk, the region, said two people had been killed after Ukraine shelled the small village of Chossy, about 5 kilometers from the border. Russian regions bordering Ukraine have repeatedly accused Kyiv's forces of indiscriminate shelling that has damaged infrastructure and caused civilian deaths. Ukraine launched its counteroffensive in June after stockpiling Western weapons, but has struggled to make major breakthroughs. Moscow said earlier Thursday it had downed 11 Ukrainian drones nearing the Crimean Peninsula and two heading for Moscow. Moscow was largely spared in the early months of the war. However, the number of drone attacks on the Russian capital has risen in recent months, with the city targeted multiple times this week. On Thursday, Russian officials gave updates following an explosion the previous day at a factory northeast of Moscow. The local investigating committee said 12 people are missing. In the Russian-occupied Ukrainian territory of Novokharkovka, one person died and 14 were wounded in the Ukrainian shelling. Zelenskiy warned last month that war was coming to Russia and that the country's symbolic centers and military bases would become targets. On the other side of the front line, an oil depot in Ukraine's Western Ravine region was destroyed during a massive drone attack. Tensions have also risen in the Black Sea since Russia exited a deal allowing safe passage for grain exports. Ukraine says it has opened maritime routes for civilian vessels from several southern ports. Remember, in July, Russia said it would consider any ships nearing Ukraine in the Black Sea as potential military cargo carriers. Ukraine Navy spokesman said a first ship would take the newly opened route in the near future. In Washington, President Joe Biden's administration asked Congress for more than $13 billion in new military spending for Ukraine. For more on this, our correspondent Susan Tehrani has sent us this report from New York.
President Biden's budget request comes as Congress is heading for a spending showdown this fall. The government has been funded until September 30th, and a short-term extension is expected until House and Senate come up with a resolution for a long-term spending bill. Biden is now asking for some $24 million for aid to Ukraine and other international matters. Of course, he's also asking for more money for infrastructure and disaster relief. However, Republicans and many across the country are concerned about America's unwavering support for Ukraine at a time when the counteroffensive has been stalling and there is no end in sight to some kind of ceasefire or negotiated settlement to the conflict. Biden's Republican opponents seem to become more popular as they oppose these blank checks to Ukraine, while the president insists that the United States will continue to support Ukraine as long as it takes. One of those in opposition is former President Donald Trump, speaking loudly against America's unwavering support in Ukraine. And, of course, many Republicans in Congress as well following his lead. Susan Tehrani reporting from New York for WION World is One.
So Russia and Ukraine are well into 18 months of the ongoing conflict, while Kiev continues to receive military support from the NATO military alliance. Moscow has now amped up its weapons, introducing what is known as the country's deadliest missile into its war treasure chest. Now, this is the Kh-50 missile that Russia has now seemingly granted operational clearance to the missile, which means that it is combat ready for war. Local media reports have revealed that the growth in production and active use of the missile in conflict with Ukraine, and the latter should be very worried. Moscow has a range of missiles at its disposal, but most of them are said to have some serious shortcomings in the context of their impact in the war. Now, most of the warring countries' missile armaments can be easily detected and neutralized by NATO's air defense systems, which have been provided to Ukraine for fighting back. This is what NATO claims. But on the ground, though, the situation appears to be different. Kh-50 is said to have a slew of features and advantages over the existing technology that Putin's army possesses. The missile has a low radar signature, giving it greater protection from air defense systems. The missile can also cut through strongly contested airspaces and can combat NATO's defense systems, a feature that is crucial in the war with Ukraine. Kh-50 has a shorter range at 1,500 kilometers, which surprisingly is an advantage, making the missile stealthier in functionality and also cheaper to produce. The smaller size of the weapon also greatly reduces its flight and warning time, a feature that can be of great disadvantage to the enemy. With the war showing no signs of slowing down, the Kh-50, touted to be Russia's deadliest missile yet, might have the capacity of causing some serious damage to Ukraine and potentially tilting the fight in its favor.
...530 days into the Russia-Ukraine war. The battle of claims and counterclaims continues. Kiev has not backed down from using drones against Moscow, while Russia has been targeting Ukraine's military posts as well. However, expert opinions say Ukraine's much-touted counteroffensive has not lived up to its hype. Ukraine has been unleashing a string of drone attacks, but Russian forces have held their ground, absorbing attack after attack. Russian officials say they shot down two Ukrainian combat drones which were headed for Moscow. Now, Russian officials say that Moscow downed seven Ukrainian drones on Monday near the Kaluga region, which is less than 200 kilometers from Moscow. And on Sunday in the Podolsky district off the outskirts of the capital city. The latest drone attack comes after Russian missile strikes on the eastern Ukrainian city of Pokrovsk on Monday. The attack killed at least nine people while wounding over 80 and destroying apartments as well. Russia says in the last week its forces intercepted unmanned drones, Storm Shadow cruise missiles and HIMARS multiple rocket launchers from Ukraine. Up until a month ago, the Russian capital had not been a target for Kiev. Though progress is being made, it is much slower than what Ukraine's Western allies would have hoped. But there is another analogy here that the drones which are being used by Ukraine, it's more of a face-saving process because they are not doing any kind of damage to Moscow. Now, according to reports, in the last 2 months, Ukrainian troops have advanced at most about 16 kilometers in two areas along the region's 160-kilometer front. While Ukrainian forces have been attacking on three fronts, using Western-supplied equipment and training, probing for weak spots along the entire 1,125-kilometer front line, Russians have spent months building the most extensive fortifications and defensive lines. From triple layers of trenches to bunkers, concrete pyramid tank traps and ditches laced with thousands of landmines, which have been laid not just for tanks but for personnel as well. And what is also going in Russia's favor is the speed at which they are able to replenish these mines once they have been used. Now, experts have raised doubts on Ukraine's capacity to recover lost ground. Despite multiple peace efforts, there are no signs of a breakthrough, let alone a ceasefire. With the balance in the conflict unlikely to change soon, Ukraine is nowhere close to gaining back its areas. Now, Russia's multi-layered defensive lines in the eastern and southern parts of the country pose
as a major hurdle. Meanwhile, Russia has not gained enough to claim a victory either. And now US is set to get to elections next year. So the question remains, will the West lose its patience with Ukraine? Will it lead to divisions among the alliance that has remained intact since the war started? Will a blame game start now that the counteroffensive has not gone as planned? Who's to blame here?
Now, as Poland ramps up security on its borders, let's in fact take a look as to what is unfolding in the battleground between Russia and Ukraine. Since Ukraine launched a counteroffensive in early June, Kiev has now urged its civilians in areas near the front lines close to the northeastern town of Kupiansk to evacuate. Now, this has come about as Russia is ramping up its assault to recapture the lost land in the conflict. Meanwhile, in Kiev's southeastern Zaporizhia region, the frontline town of Orykiev has seen some of the fiercest fighting in recent weeks. The charred walls of what used to be high-rise residential buildings could be seen across the now abandoned town. Sounds of explosions shake the ghost town. The local police chief has said that Orykiev is under Russian shelling.
Це яма наслідок ворожого авіаудару. Самі бачите її розміри. Діаметр вона метрів 20, глибиною метрів 10.
Щоденно на нашу територію обслуговування прилітає порядка 10 авіабомб. Це кожен день. Максимально там до 16 прилітало. Це не тільки Оріхів, місто Оріхів, а це і громади, і населені. Всі граничать з територією Оріхівської громади.
Meanwhile, Russia is now performing an 8-hour-long scheduled flight over the neutral waters of the Bering Sea and Arctic Ocean. Two Russian Tu-160 strategic bombers performed this exercise. And according to footage released by the ministry, the nuclear-capable supersonic aircraft were escorted by Su-35 fighter jets. Russia said that the flight was undertaken in accordance with international regulations.
The British government has expanded the list of sanctions against individuals and firms associated with Russia. In the latest, Britain has imposed sanctions on an Iranian drone maker and other foreign firms. So Britain's foreign ministry has accused Iran of supplying Russian forces with weapons and components for use against Ukraine. The sanctions, they target individuals and businesses based in Iran, Turkey, Belarus, Slovakia, Switzerland and the United Arab Emirates. There are at least 25 new entities sanctioned in all. Now, an Iranian drone maker and seven of its executives are already subject to US sanctions. These sanctions, they prohibit British entities from providing trust services to these firms and individuals. It also imposes asset freezes that will block their assets held in Britain. Now, the British government has sanctioned over 1,600 individuals and entities since the start of the Ukraine conflict.
Ukraine's repeated drone strikes into the heart of Moscow have made one thing very clear. No territory on either side of the Russia-Ukraine border is now safe from enemy attacks. What is interesting is the fact that Russia and Ukraine, instead of just relying on expensive missiles, are more and more relying on cheaper drones to strike at their targets. On the 4th of August, Kiev, in an audacious attack, struck a Russian warship that was stationed at Russia's Black Sea naval base off Novorossiysk. The video of the damaged warship Olenogorsky-Gorniak being towed to the port with the help of two tugboats has now gone viral. Even though Ukraine in its counteroffensive has so far failed to make any major headway, what is clear is that Kiev is managing to pull off some very audacious attacks on Russia with the use of naval drones.
This grainy footage, put out by the Ukrainian intelligence agencies, captures the very moment when a naval drone, armed with over 450 kilograms of explosives, rammed into the Russian warship Olenogorsky-Gorniak in the Black Sea. And hours later, the Russians were seen using tugboats to drag the half-sunk warship to the shore. But this is not the first time that Ukraine has used naval drones to strike at a Russian warship. There have been several instances in the past when a swarm of naval drones have been used by Ukraine to incapacitate the Russian warships. Ever since the 17th of July, when Russia pulled the plug on the Black Sea grain deal and declared that any ship heading to the Ukrainian ports will be treated as a legitimate military target, what has been witnessed is a coordinated campaign of missile and drone strikes that have targeted the Ukrainian ports such as Odessa, Chornomorsk, Reni and Izmail. And the Ukrainian strategy to counter the Russian onslaught on its ports appears to be the use of low-cost naval drones to inflict maximum damage on the Russian Black Sea fleet, according to the Ukrainian claims. But this is a tactic that isn't just being used by Ukraine. As this grainy footage will show you, even Russia has relied on low-cost explosive-laden drones to target Ukrainian infrastructure. On the 30th of July, recognizing the key role played by the Russian Navy in this war, and to make up for the losses sustained by its forces, Vladimir Putin announced that 30 more warships will be added to the Russian Navy by the end of this year.
Today, Russia is confidently implementing the large-scale tasks of its national maritime policy and is consistently building up the power of its navy. This year alone, 30 ships of various classes will be added to its fleet.
But the battle isn't just getting more intense on the Black Sea. Yevgeny Prigozhin's dreaded Wagner militia, which is no longer fighting in Ukraine after the botched mutiny, appears to be probing a new front along Poland's border with Belarus. An estimated 4,000 Wagner mercenaries are widely reported to be training in Belarus. But what is extremely concerning for the military strategists of the West are the numerous hybrid attacks that are being orchestrated along the Polish and the Lithuanian borders. And no less than the Polish Prime Minister Mateusz Morawiecki, who met with the Lithuanian president at the Polish side of the Suwalki Gap, has accused the Wagner group of attempting to destabilize NATO's eastern flank.
There are all kinds of hybrid attacks right on our borders, on the Lithuanian border, on the Polish border, which we have been seeing for the past 2 years. Russia and Belarus are increasing the pressure on our borders. They are increasing the number of provocations, and we have to be aware that the number of these provocations will increase. We spoke about this earlier with the President Nauseda, that this can be seen on the territory of Lithuania. I know also that it can be seen on the territory of Latvia, and we know that it is happening on ours. This is what will happen. This is what provocation is about. This is what intrigue and plotting on the part of Putin and Lukashenko is about. And this is what the operational activities on their side are about. In order to destabilize, in order to create unrest, chaos, uncertainty, and at the same time to show the weakness of NATO's eastern flank to all of our partners in NATO.
Poland is a member nation of the NATO military alliance. Any incident along the Polish or the Baltic borders will trigger Article 5 of NATO's collective security. And even though both Russia and Ukraine backed by the United States are experiencing a shortage of ammunition, what cannot be ruled out is a moment of madness along the Polish or the Baltic borders, which would plunge the whole of Eastern Europe into its biggest conflagration since the end of the Second World War.
Tensions are rising on the Belarus-Poland border. Russia's Wagner group is in Belarus, and this is not sitting right with Poland. Warsaw is planning to send 10,000 extra troops to the border. Now, this will be an addition to the border guards present there already. While 4,000 will directly support them, another 6,000 will be in the reserve. You see, Poland is fearful of hybrid attack, military incursion, and of illegal immigrants crossing into its country. At the heart of this fear is Russia's private militia, who moved to Belarus last month after an attempted mutiny. We're talking about Wagner. The mercenaries have been training Belarusian soldiers with armored vehicles and drone controls, just 5 kilometers east of the Poland border. Moreover, Poland claims Belarus has been encouraging people from the Middle East and Africa to travel to Belarus and cross the border illegally, but Poland says it is ready to tackle anything come what may.
Musimy być gotowi na różne scenariusze, nie wykluczamy żadnego, dlatego zdecydowaliśmy o tym, żeby przerzucić wojsko bliżej granicy białoruskiej, żeby wzmocnić granicę, żeby w ten sposób odstraszyć agresora. Przecież o to nam chodzi, żeby odstraszyć agresora, żeby agresor nie poważył się.
Earlier, Poland claimed two Belarus military helicopters flew about 2 kilometers into its territory. An allegation which Belarus has, of course, denied. The border between Poland and Lithuania is a line called the Suwalki Gap. This strip of land serves as a link between Belarus and the Russian exclave of Kaliningrad. If Russia-Ukraine spills over, experts believe that this will be a potential target. Russia and Belarus could close this gap to isolate Baltic republics altogether. We're talking about Estonia, Latvia and Lithuania, who could be ousted from their NATO allies in Eastern Europe. Experts say Russia could use this region to test the waters and see what an incursion into a NATO member country could bring about. Moscow is sparing no quarter when it comes to preparations. Russia says Poland has become a main instrument of United States anti-Russian policy. So Moscow is also building up forces at its western borders. This after West continues to arm NATO members, including Finland and Poland, around Russia.
Welcome to the program. Our top story today, the US and its European allies are importing vast amounts of nuclear fuel and compounds from Russia. Well, this is all according to an AP news agency report. It is providing Moscow, they say, with hundreds of millions of dollars in badly needed revenue as it wages war on Ukraine. So let's break this down. The report details how these sales, which are legal and unsanctioned, have raised alarms from non-proliferation experts and elected officials. So they say the imports are helping bankroll the development of Moscow's nuclear arsenal and complicating efforts to curtail Russia's war-making abilities. The defense on Russian nuclear products used mostly to fuel civilian reactors leaves the US and its allies open to energy shortages if Putin were to cut off supplies. Now, the challenge is likely to grow more intense as those nations seek to boost productions of emission-free electricity to combat climate change. Now, the West has been reluctant to target Russia's nuclear exports because they play key roles in keeping reactors humming. Now, Russia supplied the US nuclear industry with about 12% of its uranium last year. Europe reported getting about 17% of its uranium in 2022 from Russia. Now, many of the 30 countries generating nuclear energy are importing radioactive materials from Russia's state-owned energy corporation, Rosatom, and its subsidiaries. Now, Rosatom leads the world in uranium enrichment and is ranked third in uranium production and fuel fabrication, according to its 2022 annual report. Now, Ukrainian officials have pleaded with world leaders to sanction Rosatom to cut off one of Moscow's last significant funding streams. Zelenskiy again pressed Western leaders to target Rosatom after Russian forces captured the Zaporizhia nuclear power plant. Now, Rosatom is running the partially shut down plant. Now, International Atomic Energy Agency has repeatedly warned a radiation leak at the Russia-occupied facility could be a major disaster. The US nuclear energy industry, which largely outsources its fuel, produces about 20% of US electricity. Now, the value of Russian nuclear fallen products sent to the US hit $871 million last year. That's up from $689 million in 2021 and $610 million in 2020. Now, Europe is in a bid to largely, because it has 19 Russian-designed reactors in five countries that are fully dependent on Russian nuclear fuel. Now, they are in a bind because of that situation. Now, Europe sent nearly $828 million last year. That's how much they spent on Russian nuclear industry products, including fuel elements, nuclear reactors, and machinery. Well, for more on this topic, we've got Andreas Umland joining us, an analyst at the Stockholm Center for Eastern European Studies at the Swedish Institute for International Affairs, joining us live from Berlin. So great to have you on the program. This is very complicated and it might come as a surprise to some people, but not so much to others. What do you make of this revelation?
This is, I think, a legacy of basically 30 years of, misdevelopment of, in general, energy affairs in especially Europe, but also partly North America, where there is still a certain dependence on Russia. We had a large discussion similar to the one currently about nuclear fuel, about gas imports last year in Germany. And Germany was, for the first months after the start of Russia's large-scale invasion, still importing large amounts of Russian gas. And the argument there was by the German government, if we stop doing that, we will crush basically the German economy. And then when the German economy will be crushed and we will have social and economic and perhaps even political problems, we will not be able to help Ukraine in its war against Russia. So this is a very odd situation now repeating itself with the nuclear fuel. As long, I think, as these countries like the US, like, let's say, France, which have these dependencies still, are supporting Ukraine, I think Ukrainians sort of look at it with some tolerance. But in general, this is, of course, a very odd situation. And it's strange that this has not changed to a sufficient degree in the last 1.5 years.
Yeah, you're right to say it is rather odd, isn't it? Because actually, it's just decades of a system that is hard to change overnight. As you say, it's a difficult situation for, say, Germany, because their country is now in recession. And if they don't provide for themselves and keep their economy healthy, then, as you point out, they could have political problems domestically. How can we resolve this situation then? Because it's not going to happen overnight, is it?
The problem here are simply large lobby groups in these countries. They have money and they have political support. We had this in Germany too last year, but then actually Russia stopped exporting gas through the Nord Stream gas pipelines to Germany. And then in a way that the problem was solved. And then actually it turned out that some of the panicking that the lobbying groups were spreading, sort of scenarios that that the whole of German industry would suffer from a boycott of Russian gas imports. Then it turned out actually that it was during the last year much less catastrophic. It was actually not at all catastrophic for the German industry. We have some problems now. We are indeed heading towards a recession. But we have basically redirected the gas imports. Something like that, I think, can be also done with nuclear fuel. I think the main issue is here nuclear fuel for the nuclear power plants, but the lobbying is still too strong, as I see it, in many Western countries.
Okay, well, thank you so much indeed for your insights. It's a story we're going to be following very closely as the details slowly emerge. Andreas Umland, analyst at the Stockholm Center for Eastern European Studies at the Swedish Institute of International Affairs. Thank you.
Now, our top focus on WION, Russian air defenses downed a drone. Authorities claim that the drone was flying towards an unspecified target. According to authorities, there were no casualties. Russian Defense Ministry blamed the Ukraine for the attack, and two of Moscow's airports were temporarily shut down due to the drone flight. The drone strike inside Russia has increased since the drone attack on Kremlin in May this year. On Thursday, Russia said that it has downed 13 Ukrainian drones seeking to attack Moscow and Crimea. Earlier, Russian Defense Ministry reported explosions near the Black Sea port of Novorossiysk, which it says was carried out by the Ukrainian sea drone. Ministry says that the drones were destroyed by Russian naval ships guarding the naval base. Russia says that it has repelled the attack. But a Ukrainian intelligence source says that a Russian Navy landing ship suffered a serious damage. Meanwhile, the Russian attacks inside Ukraine has also increased. Earlier, a Russian missile struck a hotel in the Ukrainian city of Zaporizhia. The attack left one person dead and 16 others injured. Reports suggest that the United Nations staffers used the hotel when they worked in the town. It was the second strike on Zaporizhia in the recent days.
Navies conducted joint patrols in the Pacific Ocean. The warships held naval exercises involving aircraft and helicopters and repelled a mock enemy air raid. Russian Defense Ministry stated joint patrols are monitoring the sea area and protecting the objects of maritime economic activity of the two countries. The China-Russia relationship has seen major shifts since 1992. At the outset, China's population was greater than Russia's, and the two countries had very similar levels of total gross domestic product. Nowadays, China's economy is estimated to be up to 10 times bigger than Russia's. Similarly, trade with Russia is not of major importance to China in terms of value. However, the high share of raw materials, including food, in Russian exports and the transfer of Russian military technology are of strategic importance to China. Now, since 2012, when Xi Jinping was first made General Secretary of the Chinese Communist Party, the relationship has evolved in the face of what both countries consider a rising threat from the West to their regimes. Analysts say Beijing's response to the Ukraine war, referred to as pro-Russia neutrality, has so far been much closer to Moscow than it was in 2014 when Crimea was annexed. Now, at the same time, developments since Russia's invasion of Ukraine in February 2022 have increased Russia's dependency on China. There are several hundred thousand U.S. service members stationed and deployed throughout the Pacific region. It is a region that has long seen the presence of U.S. troops, but rising tensions in recent years have led to an even greater U.S. presence. Here are advancements that Russia is making, which even the West is accepting now. Now, a mandatory evacuation has been ordered for the Ukrainian city of Kupiansk and its surrounding areas as Russia intensified shelling of Kharkiv region and claimed to have captured positions near the city. Moscow has been preparing to mount an advancement on Kupiansk for several weeks now, and here's how it is all playing out. Here's a look at what's happening in the northeast of Ukraine and the importance of Kharkiv for both the nations. Now, Russia is ramping up an assault to capture territory already seized once during the conflict. We have to remind you that Kharkiv was once seized by Russia. It was seized back by Ukraine, and now Russia is again making advancements here. Kupiansk and the surrounding areas of Ukraine's Kharkiv region were recaptured by Kiev's forces in September, and Moscow has since pushed back into the region. Kupiansk city administration said residents could evacuate to Kharkiv, some 90 kilometers west, where they would have the option to move to safer regions. Now, urging children, the elderly, and the sick to leave, the official said, and I'm quoting here, "Do not neglect your safety and the safety of your loved ones." So there is definitely a scare which is out there. The warning came as Russia's defense ministry announced its soldiers had improved their position along the front line near the city, after reporting advances earlier in the week. So Russia is making advances, and all of this is happening while a counteroffensive is very much in play from the Ukrainian side. Now, a spokesperson for Ukraine's Eastern Forces confirmed on national television that Russian forces were trying to break through in the Kupiansk area. Local officials are considering forcing the evacuation of children if the escalation continues and the shelling increases even further. Now, Kharkiv, this region is central to Vladimir Putin's war. Let's understand why Kharkiv is so important. You see, Kharkiv, Ukraine's second largest city, is a major target of Russian forces and has a special place in the Kremlin's version of history. Remember, Kharkiv is closer to Russia than any other large Ukrainian city. Long a melting pot of different ethnic groups, including a large Jewish population, Kharkiv played an important role in shaping Ukraine during and after World War I. Now, you see Kharkiv, where it lies even on the Ukrainian map. It is a strategic point. It served as the first capital of the Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic, a largely Moscow-controlled entity set up in opposition to the Ukrainian People's Republic in Kiev. Now, Soviet forces in Kharkiv quickly crushed early attempts at Ukrainian statehood, seizing Kiev in February of 1918. In a historical essay on Ukraine published in 2021, Putin referred to the events of 1918. He said, and I quote here, "For those who have today given up the full control of Ukraine to external forces, it would be instructive to remember that back in 1918, such a decision proved fatal for the ruling regime in Kiev." It's essentially Putin giving a warning to Zelensky. Will Russia succeed in taking Kharkiv back again? Now, that is a question that is definitely going to be answered, and it seems that Russia is already making advancements in the region. By concentrating their efforts on Kupiansk and surrounding areas, Russia is hoping to fix Ukrainian troops in the region. Now, it seeks to prevent them from moving forward as well. It seeks to prevent them from assisting in Kiev's counteroffensive, especially in attempts to reclaim territory around Bakhmut, south of Kupiansk in Donetsk region. Now, of course, Russia is making a lot of advancements in the region, and we are tracking all the developments here on WION.
Russia recently equipped the Su-57 fighter jets with artificial intelligence-based radio communications suite. The suite improves information transmission between the aircraft and ground-based systems. The Russian Air Force expects to induct around 22 Su-57 jets by the end of 2024 and 76 by 2028. Here's more on the cutting-edge aircraft. The Su-57 is a multifunctional fifth-generation aircraft system that's used for execution of a wide range of combat tasks. The fighter provides covertness of combat operation due to low signature level in the radar field. Now, the Falcon is capable of continued supersonic cruising flight. The jet is designed to destroy all types of air, ground, and naval targets. The aircraft, it can be used day and night, including in a difficult weather and difficult interference environment when countering enemy air defense systems. The radar system, it's spread across the jet's body and armament is placed inside its fuselage. The Su-57 AI system assumes some of the pilot's functions as well, including piloting and preparations for the use of weapons. Now, in 2018, the Russian Defense Ministry signed the first contract for the supply of an initial batch of the Su-57 fighters. As per state-owned corporation Rostec, Su-57 serial reduction that has begun, and the first aircraft of the initial batch was delivered to the Ministry of Defense in 2020. So the Su-57 is currently Sukhoi's most advanced aircraft in the model lineup.
Well, it's been more than 500 days since the Russia-Ukraine war started, and both sides have been unleashing heavy weaponry in the battlefield. The United States has so far pledged the most financial support to Kyiv, but did you know that Washington could also be indirectly helping Moscow's war efforts?
Yes, despite scores of sanctions slapped by the UK, the United States, and the European Union against Russia, despite many efforts to cut Moscow's access to foreign military supplies, Russia has kept its war machine going, and the oil could well be coming to Washington. Much of Moscow's weaponry, including ballistic and cruise missiles, use components manufactured here in the United States, as well as the UK, Germany, Japan, and Israel. Reports say that microchips and processors account for about half of the components of Russian weaponry, and two-thirds of them come from American companies. But given sanctions imposed on these components, Russia has found a way around through third-country intermediaries. Media reports say that 5% of U.S. microchips are reaching Russia through Hong Kong or China. Reports point out numerous companies are located in the Czech Republic, Serbia, Armenia, Kazakhstan, Turkey, and India. Western countries are aware of this. UK sanctions businesses and individuals in Turkey, Dubai, Slovakia, and Switzerland all recently. But earlier in May, the US, UK, and EU published a list of, quote, common high priority items and warned countries that such products must not end up in Russia's hands. The list includes items like integrated circuits, semiconductors, lasers, and navigational instruments. Experts say chasing third-party intermediaries is a game of cat and mouse. Once a component gets in the hands of an intermediary, it becomes difficult to trace it, and by the time one does, it's already too late, as the product has reached the Russian land. Experts also say that a blacklist of suspected intermediaries could prove to be useful.
In the latest updates from Russia, the Russia-Ukraine conflict. Both countries continue the exchange of fire across the border. Now, Russian air defenses shot down two drones targeting Moscow in the early hours of Thursday morning. Those drones attacks, they are part of Ukraine's offensive on the Russian capital. One drone was shot down in Kaluga region, southwest of Moscow. The second drone was shot down on Moscow's central ring road. Russia also downed 11 drones near Sevastopol city in Crimea. Well, the drones attack the city as it serves as Russia's Black Sea naval base. Meanwhile, Russia's missile strikes continue to bombard Ukraine. At least two people were killed and seven were injured in a Russian missile attack on Zaporizhia on Wednesday. Well, earlier, Ukrainian officials had reported these deaths, which was corrected to two. Now, doctors were able to resuscitate one person and were assisted by police paramedics at the scene. Well, to bolster defense capabilities, Germany and Ukraine have agreed on the supply of additional Patriot air defense systems to Kyiv, defense missile systems to Kyiv. Now, the news was confirmed by Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelenskiy in his evening address on Wednesday. After receiving an extension to host German Patriot missiles, Poland is now planning to move up to 10,000 additional troops to the border with Belarus. 4,000 troops will support the border guard on the Polish border, and 6,000 will be held as reserve personnel. Now, the Polish defense ministry said that the troops will be closer to the Belarus border to scare away any aggression.
On the other hand, Ukraine urged civilians near the northeastern front line to evacuate as Russia ramped up an assault to capture the territory already seized once during the conflict. Kupiansk and the surrounding areas of Kharkiv region were recaptured by Kyiv's forces in September, but Moscow has since pushed back into the region. The Kupiansk city administration said residents could evacuate to Kharkiv, some 90 kilometers west, where they would have the option to move to safer regions, urging children, the elderly, and the sick to leave, the officials said, and I quote, "Do not neglect your safety and the safety of your loved ones." The warning came as Russia announced its soldiers had improved their position along the front line near the city after reporting advances earlier in the week. A spokesman for Ukraine's Eastern Forces confirmed on national television that Russian forces were trying to break through in the Kupiansk area. Local officials are considering forcing the evacuation of children if the escalation continues and the shelling increases. In the southern city of Zaporizhia, a Russian strike on a civilian building killed at least one person and wounded 14 others. Among the wounded were a 3-year-old girl and a 14-year-old boy. In Russia, the governor of Bryansk, the region, said two people had been killed after Ukraine shelled the small village of Chosy, about 5 kilometers from the border. Russian regions bordering Ukraine have repeatedly accused Kyiv's forces of indiscriminate shelling that has damaged infrastructure and caused civilian deaths. Ukraine launched its counteroffensive in June after stockpiling Western weapons, but has struggled to make major breakthroughs. Moscow said earlier Thursday it had downed 11 Ukrainian drones nearing the Crimean Peninsula and two heading for Moscow. Moscow was largely spared in the early months of the war. However, the number of drone attacks on the Russian capital has risen in recent months, with the city targeted multiple times this week. On Thursday, Russian officials gave updates following an explosion the previous day at a factory northeast of Moscow. The local investigating committee said 12 people are missing. In the Russian-occupied Ukrainian territory of Novakhakovka, one person died and 14 were wounded in the Ukrainian shelling. Zelensky warned last month that war was coming to Russia and that the country's symbolic centers and military bases would become targets. On the other side of the front line, an oil depot in Ukraine's Western Ravine region was destroyed during a massive drone attack. Tensions have also risen in the Black Sea since Russia exited a deal allowing safe passage for grain exports. Ukraine says it has opened maritime routes for civilian vessels from several southern ports. Remember, in July, Russia said it would consider any ships nearing Ukraine in the Black Sea as potential military cargo carriers. Ukraine Navy spokesman said a first ship would take the newly opened route in the near future. In Washington, President Joe Biden's administration asked Congress for more than $13 billion in new military spending for Ukraine. For more on this, our correspondent Susan Tehrani has sent us this report from New York.
President Biden's budget request comes as Congress is heading for a spending showdown this fall. The government has been funded until September 30th, and a short-term extension is expected until House and Senate come up with a resolution for a long-term spending bill. Biden is now asking for some $24 million for aid to Ukraine and other international matters. Of course, he's also asking for more money for infrastructure and disaster relief. However, Republicans and many across the country are concerned about America's unwavering support for Ukraine at a time when the counteroffensive has been stalling and there is no end in sight to some kind of ceasefire or negotiated settlement to the conflict. Biden's Republican opponents seem to become more popular as they oppose these blank checks to Ukraine, while the president insists that the United States will continue to support Ukraine as long as it takes. One of those in opposition is former President Donald Trump, speaking loudly against America's unwavering support in Ukraine, and of course many Republicans in Congress as well following his lead. Susan Tehrani reporting from New York for WION World is One.
The Russia and Ukraine are well into 18 months of the ongoing conflict, while Kiev continues to receive military support from the NATO military alliance. Moscow has now amped up its weapons, introducing what is known as the country's deadliest missile into its war treasure chest. Now, this is the Kh-50 missile that Russia has now seemingly granted operational clearance to the missile, which means that it is combat ready for war. Local media reports have revealed that the growth in production and active use of the missile in conflict with Ukraine. and the latter should be very worried. Moscow has a range of missiles at its disposal, but most of them are said to have some serious shortcomings in the context of their impact in the war. Now, most of the warring countries' missile armaments can be easily detected and neutralized by NATO's air defense systems, which have been provided to Ukraine for fighting back. This is what NATO claims. But on the ground, though, the situation appears to be different. KH-50 is said to have a slew of features and advantages over the existing technology that Putin's army possesses. The missile has a low radar signature, giving it greater protection from air defense systems. The missile can also cut through strongly contested airspaces and can combat NATO's defense systems, a feature that is crucial in the war with Ukraine. KH-50 has a shorter range at 1,500 kilometers, which surprisingly is an advantage, making the missile stealthier in functionality and also cheaper to produce. The smaller size of the weapon also greatly reduces its flight and warning time, a feature that can be of great disadvantage to the enemy. With the war showing no signs of slowing down, the KH-50, touted to be Russia's deadliest missile yet, might have the capacity of causing some serious damage to Ukraine and potentially tilting the fight in its favor.
...530 days into the Russia-Ukraine war. The battle of claims and counterclaims continues. Kiev has not backed down from using drones against Moscow, while Russia has been targeting Ukraine's military posts as well. However, expert opinions say Ukraine's much-touted counteroffensive has not lived up to its hype. Ukraine has been unleashing a string of drone attacks, but Russian forces have held their ground, absorbing attack after attack. Russian officials say they shot down two Ukrainian combat drones which were headed for Moscow. Now, Russian officials say that Moscow downed seven Ukrainian drones on Monday near the Kaluga region, which is less than 200 kilometers from Moscow. And on Sunday in the Podolsky district off the outskirts of the capital city, the latest drone attack comes after Russian missile strikes on the eastern Ukrainian city of Pokrovsk on Monday. The attack killed at least 9 people while wounding over 80 and destroying apartments as well. Russia says in the last week its forces intercepted unmanned drones, Storm Shadow cruise missiles and HIMARS multiple rocket launchers from Ukraine. Up until a month ago, the Russian capital had not been a target for Kiev. Though progress is being made, it is much slower than what Ukraine's Western allies would have hoped. But there is another analogy here that the drones which are being used by Ukraine, it's more of a face-saving process because they are not doing any kind of damage to Moscow. Now, according to reports, in the last 2 months, Ukrainian troops have advanced at most about 16 kilometers in two areas along the region's 160-kilometer front. While Ukrainian forces have been attacking on three fronts, using Western-supplied equipment and training, probing for weak spots along the entire 1,125-kilometer front line, Russians have spent months building the most extensive fortifications and defensive lines. From triple layers of trenches to bunkers, concrete pyramid tank traps and ditches laced with thousands of landmines, which have been laid not just for tanks but for personnel as well. And what is also going in Russia's favor is the speed at which they are able to replenish these mines once they have been used. Now, experts have raised doubts on Ukraine's capacity to recover lost ground. Despite multiple peace efforts, there are no signs of a breakthrough, let alone a ceasefire. With the balance in the conflict unlikely to change soon, Ukraine is nowhere close to gaining back its areas. Now, Russia's multi-layered defensive lines in the eastern and southern parts of the country pose as a major hurdle. Meanwhile, Russia has not gained enough to claim a victory either. And now US is set to get to elections next year. So the question remains, will the West lose its patience with Ukraine? Will it lead to divisions among the alliance that has remained intact since the war started? Will a blame game start now that the counteroffensive has not gone as planned? Who's to blame here?
As Poland ramps up security on its borders, let's in fact take a look as to what is unfolding in the battleground between Russia and Ukraine. Now, since Ukraine launched a counteroffensive in early June, Kiev has now urged its civilians in areas near the front lines close to the northeastern town of Kupiansk to evacuate. Now, this has come about as Russia is ramping up its assault to recapture the lost land in the conflict. Meanwhile, in Kiev's southeastern Zaporizhia region, the frontline town of Orykiev has seen some of the fiercest fighting in recent weeks. The charred walls of what used to be high-rise residential buildings could be seen across the now abandoned town. Sounds of explosions shake the ghost town. The local police chief has said that Orykiev is under Russian shelling.
Це яма наслідок ворожого авіаудару. Самі бачите її розміри. Діаметр вона метрів 20, глибиною метрів 10.
Щоденно на нашу територію обслуговування прилітає порядка 10 авіабомб. Кожен максимально там до 16 прилітало. Це не тільки Оріхів, місто Оріхів, а це і громади, і населені. Всі граничать з територією Оріхівської громади.
Meanwhile, Russia is now performing an eight-hour-long scheduled flight over the neutral waters of the Bering Sea and Arctic Ocean. Two Russian Tu-160 strategic bombers performed this exercise, and according to footage released by the ministry, the nuclear-capable supersonic aircraft were escorted by Su-35 fighter jets. Russia said that the flight was undertaken in accordance with international regulations.
The British government has expanded the list of sanctions against individuals and firms associated with Russia. In the latest, Britain has imposed sanctions on an Iranian drone maker and other foreign firms. So Britain's foreign ministry has accused Iran of supplying Russian forces with weapons and components for use against Ukraine. The sanctions, they target individuals and businesses based in Iran, Turkey, Belarus, Slovakia, Switzerland and the United Arab Emirates. There are at least 25 new entities sanctioned in all. Now, an Iranian drone maker and seven of its executives are already subject to US sanctions. These sanctions, they prohibit British entities from providing trust services to these firms and individuals. It also imposes asset freezes that will block their assets held in Britain. Now, the British government has sanctioned over 1,600 individuals and entities since the start of the Ukraine conflict.
Ukraine's repeated drone strikes into the heart of Moscow have made one thing very clear. No territory on either side of the Russia-Ukraine border is now safe from enemy attacks. What is interesting is the fact that Russia and Ukraine, instead of just relying on expensive missiles, are more and more relying on cheaper drones to strike at their targets. On the 4th of August, Kiev, in an audacious attack, struck a Russian warship that was stationed at Russia's Black Sea naval base off Novorossiysk. The video of the damaged warship Olenogorsky-Gorniak being towed to the port with the help of two tugboats has now gone viral. Even though Ukraine in its counteroffensive has so far failed to make any major headway, what is clear is that Kiev is managing to pull off some very audacious attacks on Russia with the use of naval drones.
This grainy footage, put out by the Ukrainian intelligence agencies, captures the very moment when a naval drone, armed with over 450 kilograms of explosives, rammed into the Russian warship Olenogorsky-Gorniak in the Black Sea. And hours later, the Russians were seen using tugboats to drag the half-sunk warship to the shore. But this is not the first time that Ukraine has used naval drones to strike at a Russian warship. There have been several instances in the past when a swarm of naval drones have been used by Ukraine to incapacitate the Russian warships. Ever since the 17th of July, when Russia pulled the plug on the Black Sea grain deal and declared that any ship heading to the Ukrainian ports would be treated as a legitimate military target, what has been witnessed is a coordinated campaign of missile and drone strikes that have targeted the Ukrainian ports such as Odessa, Chornomorsk, Reni and Izmail. And the Ukrainian strategy to counter the Russian onslaught on its ports appears to be the use of low-cost naval drones to inflict maximum damage on the Russian Black Sea fleet, according to the Ukrainian claims. But this is a tactic that isn't just being used by Ukraine. As this grainy footage will show you, even Russia has relied on low-cost explosive-laden drones to target Ukrainian infrastructure. On the 30th of July, recognizing the key role played by the Russian Navy in this war, and to make up for the losses sustained by its forces, Vladimir Putin announced that 30 more warships will be added to the Russian Navy by the end of this year.
Today, Russia is confidently implementing the large-scale tasks of its national maritime policy and is consistently building up the power of its navy. This year alone, 30 ships of various classes will be added to its fleet.
But the battle isn't just getting more intense on the Black Sea. Yevgeny Prigozhin's dreaded Wagner militia, which is no longer fighting in Ukraine after the botched mutiny, appears to be probing a new front along Poland's border with Belarus. An estimated 4,000 Wagner mercenaries are widely reported to be training in Belarus. But what is extremely concerning for the military strategists of the West are the numerous hybrid attacks that are being orchestrated along the Polish and the Lithuanian borders. And no less than the Polish Prime Minister Mateusz Morawiecki, who met with the Lithuanian President at the Polish side of the Suwalki Gap, has accused the Wagner group of attempting to destabilize NATO's eastern flank.
There are all kinds of hybrid attacks right on our borders, on the Lithuanian border, on the Polish border, which we have been seeing for the past 2 years. Russia and Belarus are increasing the pressure on our borders. They are increasing the number of provocations, and we have to be aware that the number of these provocations will increase. We spoke about this earlier with the President Nauseda, that this can be seen on the territory of Lithuania. I know also that it can be seen on the territory of Latvia, and we know that it is happening on ours. This is what will happen. This is what provocation is about. This is what intrigue and plotting on the part of Putin and Lukashenko is about. And this is what the operational activities on their side are about. In order to destabilize, in order to create unrest, chaos, uncertainty, and at the same time to show the weakness of NATO's eastern flank to all of our partners in NATO.
Poland is a member nation of the NATO military alliance. Any incident along the Polish or the Baltic borders will trigger Article 5 of NATO's collective security. And even though both Russia and Ukraine backed by the United States are experiencing a shortage of ammunition, what cannot be ruled out is a moment of madness along the Polish or the Baltic borders, which would plunge the whole of Eastern Europe into its biggest conflagration since the end of the Second World War.
Tensions are rising on the Belarus-Poland border. Russia's Wagner group is in Belarus, and this is not sitting right with Poland. Warsaw is planning to send 10,000 extra troops to the border. Now, this will be an addition to the border guards present there already. While 4,000 will directly support them, another 6,000 will be in the reserve. You see, Poland is fearful of hybrid attack, military incursion, and of illegal immigrants crossing into its country. At the heart of this fear is Russia's private militia, who moved to Belarus last month after an attempted mutiny. We're talking about Wagner. The mercenaries have been training Belarusian soldiers with armored vehicles and drone controls, just 5 kilometers east of the Poland border. Moreover, Poland claims Belarus has been encouraging people from the Middle East and Africa to travel to Belarus and cross the border illegally. But Poland says it is